Hello everyone, and thanks for watching this video. In this presentation, I will talk about executing transactions with the same isolation and consistency guarantees as snapshot isolation without space overhead. This is joint work with Oana Balmo and Willis Van Oppel from the Uni of Sydney and Karan Gupta from Nutanix. First, let me give you some context. The goal of snapshot isolation is to keep long-running transactions isolated from concurrent updates. When a transaction starts, snapshot isolation provides the transaction with a snapshot of the data, and this snapshot is independent of future updates made to the data. So in this slide, initially a key value store contains keys A to Z with values 1, 2, 3, A, B, C, etc. And the long analytics transaction is launched with these values in its snapshot. The long analytics starts scanning the store, and this is a very common pattern for analytics. Analytics queries usually scan large portions of the store to compute statistics. If another transaction executed concurrently updates B, then the store keeps the old version of B because the old version of B belongs to the long transaction's snapshot. And the old version will be kept for the duration of the long transaction, which might be hours if the long transaction scans a very large dataset. The issue is that if you launch long transactions concurrently with an update-intensive workload, the store keeps multiple versions of the updated items for the duration of the long transactions. As a consequence, the size of the store grows over time, and that's a phenomenon we call space amplification. For instance, we launched a scan of a store concurrently with an update-intensive workload on a half terabyte NVMe drive. The size of the store is shown on the graph on the right side of this slide. Initially, the store is 350 gigabytes. The size of the store grows rapidly, and we could only scan 8% of the store before running out of disk space. On a bigger drive, this single scan causes the store to quadruple in size, so that's a 3x space amplification. So snapshot isolation is great to isolate long transactions from updates. But in this paper, we question the need to keep old versions of data in the store. We make the observation that long transactions are usually analytic queries that are oblivious to the order they read data and that read data only once. The idea we propose in this paper is to propagate and delete old versions of items instead of keeping them in the store. When a transaction updates data, it creates the new version as it would have done under snapshot isolation, but once it's done committing, it propagates the old versions to other transactions and then deletes the old versions from the store. At the end of the execution of the update transaction, the store only contains the new versions and so space amplification is limited. When a transaction receives a propagated item, it gets a chance to process it, but then the propagating item is deleted and cannot be read again. Intuitively, this propagation mechanism fits many analytics queries that are oblivious to the order in which they read data and that read data only once. That being said, the interface of the store still needs to be modified to be able to handle the propagation mechanism. So we define a new type of processing that we call OLCP for online commutative processing. OLCP queries scan portions of the store. And the OLCP mechanism guarantees that the query will read all items belonging to the ranges it wants to scan exactly once, and that the read items belongs to its snapshot. So basically the read items are the same as the items it would have read under snapshot isolation. We define a new interface for OLCP queries. OLCP queries are launched using an OLCP query function. This function defines the ranges that the query wants to scan, and items belonging to these ranges are propagated instead of being versioned and may not be read in order. An OLCP query also defines point ranges, and items in these ranges are versioned as they would be under snapshot isolation and can be read in order. Finally, the query defines a map callback that will be called exactly once on all items belonging to the scan ranges. Being called exactly once is important to avoid overheads. Otherwise, a developer would have to manually remember which items have already been processed, and this would have a prohibitive memory overhead. So let me give you an example. Here, I declare an OLCP query that wants to scan the entire store. When no concurrent update executes, the query scans the entire store in lexicographic order. And the map function is called exactly once on all items belonging to the store. Now, if concurrent transactions execute, propagations might happen. Again, launch a query that scans the entire store. The query reads A, and then C is updated by a concurrent transaction. For a brief period of time, the store contains both the old version of C and the new version of C. Then, the old version is propagated to the OLCP transaction, and then processed by the OLCP transaction out of order. The old version is then deleted from the store. Then, the OLCP transaction resumes its scan from where it stopped and reads B and D. At the end of the scan, the OLCP transaction has read once again all items that belonged to its range, exactly once, and the read items belong to its snapshot. Very important is that the map function is called exactly once. We need to call the map function exactly once, otherwise a developer would have to remember which items it has already seen, and this would have a prohibitive memory overhead. So to that end, OLCP queries remember the timestamp of their snapshot and the last item they scanned, and that's it. So OLCP queries have a low memory overhead, and I will show how that works. OLCP queries use the timestamp of their snapshot to avoid propagating the same item twice. In this example, an OLCP query scans the entire store and C is updated concurrently. After the first update, the first version of C, C0, is propagated to the OLCP query, processed, and then deleted. Then the store only contains the newest version of C, C1. If C is updated again, C1 is not propagated because it is too recent for the OLCP query, and we can find this information easily by comparing the timestamp of the snapshot of the OLCP query and the timestamp of C1. The same operation is done when scanning. When the OLCP query resumes its scan, it will skip C1 because C1 is too recent for its snapshot. Remembering the last scanned item is useful to avoid propagating an item that has already been scanned. In this example, A and B are scanned, and then A is updated. A0 will not be propagated because it is lower in lexicographical order than the last scanned item. So basically, the timestamp of the snapshot and the last scanned items are sufficient to read items only once. And in the paper, we have a more complete proof of correctness if you are interested. OLCP queries can be used to perform a wide range of analytics. Obviously, OLCP can be used to perform MapReduce type operations because the interface is very similar to that of MapReduce. But OLCP can also be used to perform mathematical operations that only need to read data once, such as performing sums or counts. And it can also be used to perform aggregation operations such as group by, cube, or wrap. In the paper, we also show how to use OLCP to reduce the space overhead of joins. Let me give you an example of how to use OLCP in practice. This slide presents the first query of TPCH. The query computes a summary pricing report on items shipped before a given date. But most importantly, this query is performed during a single scan of the data. We can easily port this query to OLCP by putting the scanned data in the scanned range and computing statistics in the map function. When executed with OLCP, this query has the same guarantees as when executed under snapshot isolation. But if you have concurrent transactions that update data, under OLCP, no version is kept, and the database has no space amplification. I will conclude this talk with a brief evaluation of OLCP. In this presentation, I will just focus on one machine, which is a four-core machine with an obtained drive, and one workload, YCSBT. In YCSBT, we use 1 kilobyte items, and we have a database that has 100 million elements. The workload is very write-heavy, so updates are grouped in transactions, and every transaction performs approximately 16 updates. And concurrently with this update-intensive workload, we run a scan of the database. And this scan either runs using standard snapshot isolation or OLCP. The most important result is the number of version items. When this scan is executed using standard snapshot isolation, the database has to keep the old versions of items in the database. As a consequence, the number of version items grows over time. And after 1500 seconds, the database has accumulated over 350 million items. At that point, the database runs out of disk space and it aborts the scan. With OLCP, old versions are propagated to the scan and are not kept in the database, so the number of version items stays close to zero for the entire duration of the scan. The second result is the speed of scans. Surprisingly, scans are much faster using OLCP than using standard snapshot isolation. With standard snapshot isolation, the scan has a roughly constant throughput through time, because it reads most of its data from disk. With OLCP, data is propagated, and usually propagated items are read from memory, and so the scan is much faster than if it had read data from disk. The effect is particularly visible at the beginning of the scan, because at the beginning of the scan, most propagations are useful and result in a read from memory. And as the scan progresses, it's less and less likely that propagations will be useful, and so the throughput at the end reaches the same throughput as with snapshot isolation. The third result is the effect of OLCP on concurrent update transactions. This graph shows the throughput of concurrent updates over time. The scan with OLCP lasts around 600 seconds, and after 600 seconds, the throughput of updates goes up because the scan is over. So OLCP interferes less with updates on average than standard snapshot isolation. When the scan runs, both OLCP and snapshot isolation have the same impact on concurrent updates. This shows that propagations do not have any overhead or adverse effects on performance. You might also notice a dip at 1500 seconds when the snapshot isolation scan aborts. It's because the database has to clean over 350 million old items, and the garbage collector stalls the database for a few seconds while cleaning the old versions. In the paper, we have more results. We explain how to perform efficient propagations. We talk more about concurrency issues. We have more examples of TPCH queries that we ported to OLCP, and we have a much more detailed evaluation. So in conclusion, we have seen that snapshot isolation induces large space overheads, especially when long queries run concurrently with an update-intensive workload. We have seen that these long queries are usually analytical queries that read data once and are oblivious to the order in which they read data. So for these queries, propagating items makes sense instead of versioning them in the database. We have seen that the propagation mechanism is efficient and does not induce any overhead. Also, I have seen that propagating data can help speeding up analytical queries. The code of our OLCP implementation is available on GitHub, so feel free to fork it. And if you have questions, you can contact me either on GitHub or by email. Thanks for listening to this talk.